الرحيم إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونستهديه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا وسيئات أعمالنا من يهد الله فهو المهتد ومن يضلل فلن تجد له وليا مرشدا وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله وسلم عليه تسليما كثيرا إلى يوم الدين ثم أما بعد. Brothers and sisters in Islam, last Jumu'ah we spoke about or we stopped at the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam when he asked his companions, do you know who is the pauper? Do you know who is the bankrupt person? Then the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, they said that the bankrupt person or the pauper is the person that has no money. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam elucidated the point, said that the pauper or the bankrupt person among my followers is the person that will come in the day of judgment with salah, siyam, fasting the month of Ramadan, zakah, charity, but in the contrast of that, he had abused somebody. He had slandered against somebody. He had usurped the goods, the money, the wealth of somebody else. He had taken the money of somebody else unjustly. And we gave the example of purchasing or buying from some Muslims. You know, sometimes some Muslims, they deal with you because you are Muslim. They purchase from you because you are Muslim. They buy from you because you are Muslim. Because of the bond that we share, we as Muslims. So some people, they deal with you based upon that. And according to the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he said, al-Muslimu akhu al-Muslim, that the Muslim is a brother to another Muslim. لا يظلمه ولا يحقره, that he does not abuse him, does not disappoint him, and he does not oppress him. And subhanAllah, in the same hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, التَّقْوَى هَامُنَا. He pointed at his chest and he said, the fearness, the consciousness of Allah is inside the heart. Meaning, don't be deceived by the looks. You might find a person, mashallah, good looking, good Muslim looking, mashallah. You might find a person who does all the physical aspects of Islam, all the physical aspects of deen. You find him 5 times a day in the masjid. You find him paying the zakah. You find him, mashallah, good looking. But he has, you know, the heart of shayateen. He's one of the worst people on the planet. So don't be surprised. Don't say, oh, the person does this and this. But in contrast of that, you know, he's violating other Muslims. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has already given us the example of that. This person will be bankrupt on the day of judgment. So don't think that because of your deeds, because of your good deeds, because of your a'mal, because of your salah, because of the fasting of Ramadan, then Jannah is a given. The paradise is a granted. If you haven't rectified those issues, if you haven't returned the deposit to its owners, which is why the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, مَنْ كَانَ لَهُ مَظْلَمَةٌ مِنْ أَخِيهِ مِنْ عِرْضٍ أَوْ شَيْءٍ فَلِيتَحَلَّلْ مِنْهُ الْيَوْمِ قَبْلَ أَنْ لَا يَكُونَ دِينَارٌ وَلَا دِرْهَمٌ. That if any Muslim has oppressed his brother concerning his honor or anything else, let him obtain his pardon today. Let him ask for forgiveness today. Meaning in this world, while you are still alive, before the time comes when will be no dinar, no dirham, no currency, no money to pay the person, i.e. he will be penniless, will be broke. If the aggressor, as the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, if the aggressor may have any good deeds, then the same will be deducted from his account in equal proportion to his wrongs. And if he runs out of good deeds, if he has no good deeds, then the wrongs of the aggrieved will be added to his account definitely in equal proportion. وَلَا يَظْلِمُ رَبُّكَ أَحَدًا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not treat anybody unjustly. Why? Because in the day of judgment, when you stand in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you find no hasanat, no good deeds in your account because of your backbiting, because of your violating to another Muslim. And if you want to know how dangerous, or if you want to know how dangerous is the backbiting, you need to look no further than the statement in the hadith when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed to Musa that, Ya Musa, اعلم أن من تاب من الغيبة ثم مات كان آخر من يدخل الجنة، ومن لم يتب من الغيبة ثم مات كان أول من يدخل النار. But O Musa, know that if a person repents from backbiting and dies, he would be the last to enter into the paradise. Here's a person repents from backbiting, yet he will be the last to enter into the paradise. And if the person does not repent and dies on backbiting, then he will be the first to enter into the hellfire. Why? Because he's given his good deeds to another person who does not deserve. Ibn Mubarak, rahimahullah, one of our great scholars, he said, لو كنت مغتابا لاغتبت أمي فإنها أولى بحسناتي. He said, I don't backbite anybody, but if I wish, if I'm forced to backbite any person, then I would backbite my mother, because she has the first priority over my good deeds. My parents have the first priority over my good deeds, especially if the person does not forgive you, as it happened with Ibn al-Jala, one of the scholars. In the past, some people, they came to him and they told him, you know, we backbited you, we spoke bad about you, please forgive us. Ibn al-Jala said, wallahi, I won't forgive you. They said, please, umhuha, erase that good deed which we gave you. He said, wallahi, I won't erase it. It's one of the most beautiful good deeds. مرحبا بحسنة لم أعملها. Welcome to the world, to the reward. Welcome to the good deed that I never done. But I didn't sweat doing it. I made no effort doing it. Welcome to a reward, because you are backbiting me. I won't forgive you, and I won't erase it. You are busy talking bad about me. You are busy trashing my reputation. You are busy giving bad image about me. You are busy creating fitna between two Muslims by backbiting me. Now you come to me and you tell me, forgive me. Some people, they don't speak to me because of you, because of your fitna. Now you come to me and tell me, forgive me. I won't forgive you. Because it's a major sin. It's a major sin. It's an unforgivable sin. Imam Malik, rahimahullah, he heard someone who backbited him. What did Imam Malik, rahimahullah, do? He told his wife to prepare a cake, or to prepare some sweets, and he gave it to the person. The person told him, why would you give me that? Imam Malik, rahimahullah, said, no, wallahi, I didn't find anything to compensate you with. I didn't find anything to reward you with instead of giving you this, because you gave me your good deeds. You gave me your hasanat. So I didn't find anything to give it to you as a reward. Only this sweets. Thank you so much. Yeah, carry on. You are giving me your good deeds. Someone came to Hassan al-Basri, rahimahullah, one of our scholars, and he told him that I heard that you are backbiting me. And Hassan al-Basri is one of the righteous people at his time. He's one from the Tabi'een, the generation that came right after the Sahaba. And he told Hassan al-Basri that he accused him by backbiting. So Hassan al-Basri, rahimahullah, told him, لم يبلغ من القدر لم يبلغ قدرك عندي أن أحكمك في حسناتي. He told him, you didn't reach the level for you to put you in charge of my good deeds. Meaning you are not eligible. You are not competent enough to put you in charge of my good deeds. You are not worthy. And you have to know that when you, before backbiting anybody, before talking bad about anybody, you have to know that you are literally putting the person in charge of your good deeds. No, none of us wants to give his bank details or his card, the card of the bank and the PIN to somebody and tell him, do whatever with my money. Nobody will do that. And if somebody does it, it's insane. So how would you do it with your good deeds? How would you do it with your vehicle? Or how would you do it with your key to enter into the paradise, which is the good deeds? You are struggling to pray Fajr on time. You are struggling to pray Salah on time. You are struggling to open the Mus'haf and read the Quran. You are struggling to get some hasanah during the day. You are struggling to pay your zakah. You are struggling to do any good deed. Then by the end of the day, you give it to somebody else because of backbiting. Just easily like that. Subhanallah. And in the day of judgment, you find yourself bankrupt because of backbiting Muslims.
So when someone that bites you, then you have to know, or someone that talks about you in your, at your back, or talks behind you, the person is literally, actually is behind you. He is at your back. Because he doesn't have the courage to face you head on and tell you this is right or this is wrong or there is this issue. And when the person backbites you, then you have to know, you have to be happy. Not literally or literally happy, but the person is giving you from your good deeds, from his good deeds. So, sometimes, but Islam all the time, you know, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the Quran, وَلْيَعْفُوا وَلْيَصْفَحُوا, let them pardon one another, let them forgive one another, in order Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive you as well. But sometimes, you don't forgive the person. Why? Because some people, if you keep on forgiving, they will persist on the disobedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They will persist on the sin. They will continue doing sins. They will continue with the disobedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So you tell them, I don't forgive you, for them to rectify their own selves, for them to be a better Muslim. Maybe they will be a better Muslim when you tell them, no, I don't forgive you. You backbited me. Take responsibility. I don't forgive you. Because if you are, you know, forgivable person all the time, no, I forgive you. People, they will take advantage of that. And they will take your right because you are a forgiving person. So forgiving is good, but sometimes not forgiving is also good. In order to save the person from the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because we don't want to see any Muslim under the anguish or under the wrath or the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We want all the Muslims, all our Muslim brothers to be in Jannah. We don't want to take any good deeds from any Muslim. But some people, they, you know, they don't have the fearness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They don't fear Allah. So you have to tell them, no, I don't forgive you. I will meet you in the day of judgment. But this you have to do it sometimes. You know the person. If you know the person, you have to do it with them. But mostly you have to forgive your Muslim brother. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants us to repent to him. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the Quran, وَاللَّهُ يُرِيدُ أَنْ يَتُوبَ عَلَيْكُمْ. Allah wishes to accept your repentance. Allah wishes to accept your repentance. Why? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not want to punish anybody. لَا يَفْعَلُ اللَّهُ بِعَذَابِكُمْ. Why should Allah punish you if you have faked him and if you have believed in him? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created us to have mercy on us. So what you have to do, if any Muslim is suffering from backbiting, first of all, as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was asked, what is the kafara, what is the expiation of backbiting? He said, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, is to mention the person after repenting to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is to mention the person in the same gathering or with the same people with a good manner or in a good way, as you mentioned him before, in a bad way, to rectify this mistake. But first and foremost, you have to repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And before leaving this place, I want everybody, when he goes out of this masjid, and take a pledge to yourself, take a pledge to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that inshallah from today I won't backbite any person. From today I won't give even one single good deed to any person. Cry to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the sujood. Say, Allah, I don't want to give my good deeds to any person. I don't want to backbite any person. As the door of Tawbah is open. The door of Tawbah is always open. The door of Tawbah will be closed two times. When the sun is departing from the body, and when the sun rises from the west. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, حَتَّى إِذَا جَاءَ أَحَدَهُمُ الْمَوْتُ وَقَالَ إِنِّي تُبْتُ الْآنِ. Some, when the death, when they see the process of death, they say, no, I repent to Allah now. Now I can make tawbah. But tawbah is not accepted by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Every day Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given you a new day. Why? Why? You have to ask yourself, where do Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala given you a new day every day? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants you to go back to him. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants you to repent. Every day a new day, every day a new chance. Oh, my servant, come back to me. Oh, my servant, repent from your bad deeds. Repent from the disobedience. أفحسبتم أنما خلقناكم عبثا؟ Do you think that we created you vainly? Do you think that you know day and night, every day, you know the time passes fast? Why the time passes fast? Why? Why day and night? Allah Subhanahu wa Taala is giving us a chances to be a better Muslims. And so, instead of backbiting others, we'll be rectifying our own self. You'll be busy putting yourself on the right path. As one of the Salihin, they told him, we never heard you backbiting any person. We never heard you talking about any person. He said, لست عن نفسي راضي. I'm not pleased with myself. I'm not happy with myself. I'm not happy with my faults. I'm busy rectifying my faults. How do you want me to talk about somebody else while I have my own flaws? I'm not praying the correct salah. I don't have khushu in salah. I have all this showing off and riya. I have all these faults and flaws. Meanwhile, you want me to talk about somebody else. I'm not happy with myself either. But backbiting is allowed as an exception. As the ulama, they said that the backbiting is allowed as an exception. As the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, لا غيبة لفاسق. لا غيبة لفاسق. That the deviant person or those who they expose their, or they expose openly their wrongdoings, then if you talk about them with their wrongdoings, it's not a backbiting. But it has to be with a reason. It has to be with a reason in order of a complaint from somebody from the oppressed. If someone was oppressed by somebody else and it comes to you and tells you, please, we need to find a solution. This person does this, this person does that. Please, we need to find a solution. Now, this is not a backbiting. And we have those people in our community, in our society, that are very known by their sins. A person who exposes his own son in front of everybody, if you speak about him, if you talk about him, then it's not a backbiting. It's not considered as a backbiting. Or in order to remove a sin, to ask help or assistance, to remove a sin or to remove a munkar. But it has to be with a valid reason, not just backbiting a person, but it has to be with a valid reason. And secondly, is to save a fellow Muslim from being cheated and to exhort the seeker of truth. And this can happen, especially in marriages. When somebody comes to you and tells you, I want to marry my daughter to your friend, or your friend, your brother, comes to me proposing my daughter, what do you think about your friend? What do you think about your brother? Here you have to say the truth. If he's a good person, say he is a good person. If he's not a good person, don't say, no, he's a good person. No, you have to say he's not a good person. And don't say, no, I can't tell you anything. I don't take the responsibility. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَلَا تَكْتُمُ الشَّهَادَةِ. Do not conceal the evidence. وَمَنْ يَكْتُمْهَا فَإِنَّهُ آثِمُ قَلْبُهُ. And he who hides it, then his heart is sinful. Someone comes to me, to you, even asking you about your own brother, you have to say the truth. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the Quran, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا كُنُوا قَوَّمِينَ بِالْقِسْطِ شُهَدَاءَ لِلَّهِ وَلَوْ عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِكُمْ أَوْ الْوَالِدَيْنِ أَوْ الْأَقْرَبِينَ. That all you who believe, be truthful, be the sayers of truth, even against yourself, even against the parents, even against your relatives. If someone comes to you and asks you about your brother, you know, for marriage or for work or anything, tell him the truth. As one of the Sahaba radiallahu anhu said, بَيَعْتُ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ عَلَى إِقَامِ الصَّلَاةِ وَإِتَاءِ الزَّكَاةِ وَالنُّصْحِ لِكُلِّ مُسْلِمٍ. That I pledged allegiance to the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. I made my covenant to the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم to establish a salah and to pay the zakat and to consult every Muslim, to give an advice to every Muslim. When somebody comes to you asking you about a worker, that I want to employ this worker in my shop or in my business, what do you think about this worker? You have to be honest and you have to tell the person the truth, that this person is honest, this person is not trustworthy, or this person is a good person. You have to say the truth. If you know the person, definitely. If you don't know the person, tell him, no, I know him superficially, but I don't know him, you know, deeply. But you have to say the truth. And this is the right of you to other Muslims. والنصح لكل مسلم is to advise every Muslim that asks or requires for نصيحة or for an advice. Don't say no, don't speak no, I can't say anything. You have to say it because this is one of the rights of the Muslim. Same thing applies with the work. If someone comes to you and tells you what you think about this person, tell him the truth. But not you to go to other to that worker and tell him, no, you know what the person told me about you. He told me that you are trustworthy. This is the namima. This is the gossip, which is one of the dangers of the tongue. And this is what we are going to talk about in the next Jum'ah. Subhanakallahumma bihamdik. Nashhadu an la ilaha illa anta. Astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk.